As we move on to the next item of business, which is a members' business debate on motion 10284 in the name of Gillian Mackay on environmental impact of single-use vapes. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. It is heavily subscribed, so members will have to stick to their speaking allowances, and those speaking later in the debate I've already spoken to will be required to speak to a slightly tighter time schedule. And with that, I invite Gillian Mackay to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I want to begin by recognising the strength of feeling on this issue in the Chamber and to thank everyone for contributing today. The fact we are so tight on time is very heartening and points to how seriously this Chamber is taking this issue. I know there's work going on in many offices across the Chamber to tackle this, and I want to thank those who attended one or both of the roundtables on this issue that I've chaired. I also want to thank campaigners such as Laura Young, the Marine Conservation Society, Ash Scotland, Asthma Lung UK, the British Heart Foundation, the Royal College for Paediatric and Child Health, the Daily Record, the Inverness Courier and many more who've helped and contributed to the campaign so far. There's more to do and more roundtables to come, and I encourage everyone here to join in the discussions. As mentioned in my motion, I'd like to thank the Scottish Government, and particularly my colleague Lorna Slater and Zero Waste Scotland, for the work that was commissioned into the environmental impact of single-use vapes. The review showed that the total emissions associated with single-use vapes in 2022 was estimated to be between 3,375 and 4,292 tonnes of CO2. That's the equivalent to 2,100 cars on the road. It also showed the weight of packaging and materials discarded as a result of single-use e-cigarette consumption in Scotland is currently between 800 and 1,000 tonnes per year. Other figures also show that last year 1.3 million single-use vapes were thrown away every week in the UK, although this is likely to be far higher now. This is a looming environmental catastrophe. For local authorities and waste processing companies, there's a real concern about the fire risk associated with the incorrect disposal of these devices. They're also difficult to recycle in the first place, as they're made of mixed materials and the lithium batteries are particularly resource intensive to make. Many of these discarded batteries are ending up in our beaches and green spaces, as well as in our towns and cities. And I've seen discarded batteries in between cobbles in Edinburgh and at home in Falkirk. Some of our most iconic streets are being littered by these products. The sheer number being thrown away is astonishing. In the middle of a climate crisis, the last thing we actually need is to have another polluting single-use product. And a ban on disposables, in my opinion, is the minimum we have to do to protect the planet. There are, of course, issues with the packaging on refillable vapes too, and we do need to look at that now to ensure that we're not merely moving the litter problem along the line. There's also an issue with illegal vapes, and we don't know if they are any more environmentally damaging than others. The composition of these is much more difficult to find, especially when new products come on the market. Preventing the importation of them by looking at how the current registration and licensing scheme is done, I think, should also be a priority. We will need to take that approach on a Four Nations basis to ensure that the importation of vapes is tracked. And I will be writing to Scottish Government and UK Government ministers in the coming days to ask them to work with me on a way forward on this. It's essential that we see the health, environmental, trading standards, licensing and regulation issues as a whole when we're dealing with single-use vapes. To see less vapes discarded, we need to help people give up nicotine altogether, regulate, tax and license these products better, stop the supply of single-use vapes to young people, and crucially, I know for many people in this chamber, prevent young people from being tempted to take vaping up. We need retailers to step up and do what they can to reduce the environmental and health impact of these products. I wrote to retailers to ask them to put these behind cover and treat all nicotine-based products in the same way. I got very few responses, and those that I did said they would wait and comply with whatever regulations come forward. We should be using the current regulation-making powers we have to make retailers put these products behind cover. We need to bring in plain packaging and ensure that flavours are either removed or restricted heavily so that we don't have blue bubblegum, candy floss and rainbow unicorn, just to name a few. I do expect that in talking about flavours, we'll get the usual cries of, but adults enjoy colours and flavours too. But I know no adult, and this is coming from me, who loves a pick and mix or two, would be influenced by the name Rainbow Unicorn to try it. I do, however, know plenty of young children who would be tempted by that. Advertising and the presence of these products in TV programmes and on social media needs to be taken seriously, and I'm grateful to the ASA, who wrote to me in the last couple of days detailing action that they're already taking to address this, but we need to remain vigilant. Presiding Officer, we often get branded as killjoys when we try to do good things in both environmental and public health policy areas. We're seen as stopping people from doing things that they enjoy. But this is far too important an issue to be worried about being seen in that way, and I encourage colleagues from across the chamber to take a bold stance on this. For the sake of the environment, and importantly for all of us, the sake of the health and well-being of children and young people, this has to be done. They should have been the generation that had the lowest ever rate of nicotine addiction. That's still absolutely achievable, but only if all of us put their needs at the forefront of our minds. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call the first speaker in the open debate, Rona Mackay, to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome today's important debate, and I thank my colleague Gillian Mackay for bringing it to the Chamber. The motion for today's debate and Gillian Mackay's opening speech really says it all, and I won't repeat the shocking statistics in the motion regarding the devastating environmental impact disposable vapes is having and the impact on children and young people. I'll go on to say a bit more about that. Firstly, though, I'm delighted that the Scottish Government has committed its programme for government to take action to tackle the damage done by single-use vapes and are consulting on a proposal to ban their sale. Scotland is leading the way in the UK on this hugely important issue, and this is a perfect example of our government saying no, we will not allow this damage to continue in our country. Good legislation protects people and the environment, and I'm proud that we are leading the way. Because the harm disposable vapes does to our parks, rivers and beaches is incredibly serious. With millions of vapes littered every year, there's a significant and increasing cost to local authorities through litter clear-up and waste management. The vapes contain copper wires and lithium batteries, incredibly dangerous to children and animals, and they're hugely difficult to dispose of responsibly. My understanding is that so far a total of 29 out of Scotland's 32 councils, including the local authority in my constituency, Eastern Bartonshire Council, have come out in support of a ban after discussing motions. The upsurge in vaping by young people, highlighted by leading health charities such as ASH Scotland and Asthma Lung UK Scotland, is also incredibly concerning, driven by the popularity of cheap, sweet-flavoured, brightly coloured disposable vapes, as Gillian Mackay has highlighted. They're hooking children in, just as Alcopops did, to a world of addiction. In a previous debate on this subject, I highlighted the supposedly cool online merchandise aimed at kids to allow them to vape undetected by parents or teachers. Make no mistake, this is an insidious industry. As ASH Scotland has pointed out, most vapes include nicotine, which is highly addictive, and toxic e-liquids that have not been safely tested for inhalation and could risk damage to growing lungs. The number of primary school children who are vaping has reached epidemic levels and is a major public health concern. A single disposable vape can last for 600 puffs, the equivalent of smoking a pack of 20 cigarettes. And according to Zero Waste Scotland, the lithium batteries used in the most popular disposable vapes could be recharged up to 500 times if the programme design allowed. The dangers of single-use vapes in the environment are immense. Let's be clear, they were never a good thing and are produced simply to make profit for large companies. An investigation by the Daily Record revealed a school fire in the Borders just before the start of the summer holidays this year was blamed on vape lithium battery shorting on the inside of a metal bin on a stairwell. The Daily Record has been at the forefront of calling for a ban on single-use vapes and highlighting health concerns, and I really commend them for this. As campaigner Laura Young, known as the Vape Crusader, told the newspaper, teachers have a hard enough job to do without being on monitoring duties, making sure kids don't have vapes. A survey last month showed 4 in 5 Scots back outlawing disposable vapes. YouGov poll found 77% of adults in Scotland either strongly or somewhat support a ban on the products, with identical figures for the UK as a whole. So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, earlier this year, Keep Scotland Beautiful called on all Scottish retailers to voluntarily stop displaying single-use vapes, following in the footsteps of Waitrose, who have taken them off their shelves, I believe. So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, let's get rid of these harmful products. They do nothing but harm to Scotland's people and environment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mackay. I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Mercedes Vialba. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to contribute today and acknowledge Gillian Mackay for securing this member's debate and congratulate her on the work that she's doing in the field. As you know, Deputy Presiding Officer, and many in the Chamber, I am very happy to work alongside my colleague Emma Harper as the co-convener of the cross-party group on lung health, and it is my privilege to once again in this session continue my role as the Parliamentary Smoking Cessation Champion for Asthma and Lung UK. The ticking time bomb of youth vapes, and especially those of single-use disposable type, appears to be one of our biggest challenges we face, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is in no small part due to the age and the demographics of the audience that the manufacturers are unashamedly and scandalously targeting. Indeed, Gillian Mackay's motion recognises in the year ending January 2023, there have been reported of estimate of 543,000 vapes in Scotland, of which 9% were under 16 and 14% were under the age of 18. This is only set to get worse unless something dramatic is done, Deputy Presiding Officer. During the last few months, the Local Government Association in England has reported that for the first time, its members and council have called for single-use vapes to be banned on environmental and health grounds. The LGA also points to the single-use vapes are designed as a unit, and the batteries cannot be separated from the plastic, making it almost impossible to recycle without going through some special treatment. The lithium batteries inside the plastics can sharply increase in temperature, we've heard that already, and they can become flammable, and that is a major concern. This costs the taxpayer millions of pounds in damaged equipment and specialised treatment, and it's dealing with a hazardous waste. Research from the non-profit organisation Material Focus has shown that there could be up to 5 million single-use vape units are being thrown away in the United Kingdom. This would mean four times the figure that we've talked about during 2022. This amounts to 8 vapes a second being discarded, with lithium batteries products which are enough to create 5,000 electric car batteries a year. Frightening statistics, Deputy Presiding Officer, but we must challenge them. I also echo the extreme concerns that groups such as Asthma and Lung UK Scotland and ASH Scotland and parents and carers and teachers have talked about the impact that vaping is having on children and young people. And we know from the reports that we've seen and the campaigns that are being dealt with how harmful this is becoming. The phenomenon is deeply worrying, and it's been targeted primarily at young people and children. It appears to be very fashionable at present, and the displaying that takes place is encouraging peer groups to be thinking that something of this nature is something good to do, it's cool to do. That is anything but, and we need to manage that and challenge that. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, anti-smoking groups and charities, as well as medical professionals, and especially concerned about the vaping that's taking place, their designs are flavoured, and they appear to attract children. They're an attempt with their fruity and bubblegum flavours and the ice flavours, and the whole idea is trying to encourage young people and children especially. The packaging does that. They're often right at the point of sale, and we know that, and the retailers have to take a strong view, because that is very similar to what sweets and confectionery may be. So strict new measures to regulate the display and marketing are definitely needed in the way that we deal with tobacco, because it's needed now to secure that support. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. I now call Mercedes Vialba to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Vialba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin, like others have, by congratulating Gillian Mackay for securing this members' business debate on the environmental impacts of single-use vapes, and also for the work that she and her team have done to raise this issue in Parliament. As MSPs, we have a unique position to use our platforms to amplify the work of campaigners across the country. So I hope everyone in today's debate will join me in commending the efforts of environmental campaigner Laura Young for her tireless work on this issue. In fact, it was after hearing about Laura's work that I first became involved in the issue. Laura was kind enough to take me out on a vape walk. This was an opportunity to go out with her, walk the streets of Dundee, and see if we could find any discarded vapes on the streets, and also to learn more about the issue along the way. And as well as giving up her time to tackle this issue and to meet with me, to educate me, Laura also encouraged local student activists to get involved. She's inspiring the next generation of environmental campaigners, so I would like to take this opportunity to put my thanks on the record today to Laura for her perseverance and commitment. And I would like to say to Laura, keep campaigning, you're getting results. So back in Dundee on our vape walk, in just an hour, Laura and I found 63 single-use vapes discarded on the streets in and around the university campus. Laura explained that this wasn't unusual, especially following a Friday or a Saturday night out. So we decided to make some inquiries on campus and in the local shops that sell these disposable vapes to try to find out what the realistic alternative to littering was. And what we found, Presiding Officer, was that there weren't any safe disposal points in the shops and around the shops that were actually selling these products. And so the best that we could hope for was that people would dispose of these single-use vapes in ordinary waste bins. But the problem with simply putting them in the bin is that, yes, it would keep them off of our streets, so it might look nicer, but it wouldn't actually make our environment any cleaner because they would eventually end up in landfill or in incinerators and would still be polluting our soil and our air. And worse still, there have been multiple instances, as we've heard today, of improperly disposed of vapes or their what's known as zombie batteries, causing fires and hazards at waste processing sites, which puts the workers there at risk. So this has led to calls for improved recycling facilities to help deal with the mounting number of disposable vapes. But disposable vapes don't just harm the environment when they're discarded after use, they're also having an impact at source. These vapes, many of which will be used for just a day or night, use scarce resources, and we simply cannot afford to discard things like the lithium in the batteries which power the vapes after just one use. That lithium could instead be used to power our transition away from fossil fuels. So I don't believe that improved recycling or design regulations are the answer. Instead, we must see an outright ban on single-use vapes in Scotland. And since my first vape walk with Laura, support for a ban has grown, starting with Dundee City Council in the region I represent, until the...
You do need to conclude, Ms. Vialba.
Okay. Support has risen to 26 councils and a range of organisations.
Thank you, Ms. Vialba. I'm going to have to ask you to stop. I did indicate at the beginning I was going to rigorously enforce the time limits to allow everybody a chance to speak. I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Brian Whittle. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too congratulate Gillian Mackay for securing debating time on this vitally important matter. And just after the debate began, I received the answer to a written question in which I asked whether the Scottish Government was going to increase the fines for retailers who sell to under-18s, as has been proposed by the UK Vaping Industry Association. And the answer from the Minister, Jenny Minto, was no. So I would hope that the Scottish Government will reconsider that. By 2021, the number of Scots who smoked had dropped to 11% following legislative changes, including banning smoking in enclosed public places and workplaces, the sale of packs of 10 cigarettes and menthol cigarettes. But there's still a huge issue in many communities, with 32% of adults in their poorest income quintile smoking compared to 6% in the most prosperous. and it's now evident that one nicotine addiction has been replaced by another. Upon entering the market, vapes were said to deliver nicotine whilst avoiding many of the harmful ingredients in cigarettes. Nevertheless, scientists are still unclear about the extent of damage vapes cause, particularly to children and young adults. Well, I've only got 4 minutes, so sadly I don't think so, unfortunately, although I would love to. And with an estimated 76,000 under-18s vaping in Scotland, primarily using single-use vapes, it's evident these colourful, fruit-flavoured, cheap devices are no longer only a means to quit smoking. For as long as single-use vapes are sold, placed beside sweets in shops, often in special offer, we're encouraging younger people to damage their health. I welcome recent reports that the UK government will also explore the banning of single-use vapes following consultation on youth vaping. However, last week it was reported that the Tories accepted a £350,000 donation from Sandeep Singh Chadha, director of Supreme 8 Limited, a UK-based company that distributes Elf Bars, a vape that regularly is found littered around Scotland. In Elf Bar, flavours include watermelon bubblegum and cotton candy ice, unequivocally aimed at enticing children and young people. And the UK government's official briefing on banning free vape samples being distributed to children endorsed Juul Labs, claiming the company was a leader in combating youth vaping. This same company has received the most complaints of any vape-producing company for fueling an epidemic of youth vaping in the US, agreeing to pay over $1 billion to settle claims that they unlawfully promoted products to children. This is highly concerning, suggests that the UK government policy on youth vaping could be determined by the interests of the industry rather than evidence. We know tobacco companies profit from industry-induced nicotine addiction, attracting people as young as possible. The UK cigarette market is the largest in Western Europe, worth £2.6 billion in 2021. So given that the UK's five top-selling tobacco companies held over one-third of shares in the global e-cigarette market as of 2021, the so-called health benefits of vaping are clearly not the driver to further increasing sales. WHO described tobacco industry interests as, and I quote, fundamentally and irreconcilably opposed to the aims of public health. These same companies are currently dictating the vaping market that tens of thousands of children and young people buy into. The earlier children and young adults become addicted to nicotine, the higher the likelihood they will continue to buy vapes for the rest of their lives or switch to cigarettes. 10% of young vape users admit to throwing the devices on the ground after use, as Laura Young's Ban Disposal Vapes campaign highlighted through her regular litter picks. And I'm doing a litter pick on the beach myself on Monday, so no doubt I'll find some too. Almost half of young vapers said the packaging doesn't provide any disposable information, such as where to send used batteries. And in the last year, 13 million disposable vapes were incorrectly disposed of in Scotland, including 2.6 million that were littered. Given e-cigarette companies are not taking responsibility for the health impacts of waste pollution they cause, it's essential the Scottish Government acts to ban these devices that harm both the environment and the well-being of Scots. With several other European countries considering bans, Scotland taking steps to stop the sale of single-use vapes, a significant opportunity
to
re-establish ourselves as a leading public health nation. I support this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Claire Adamson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also join with others in thanking Gillian Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber? It's an issue that I've spoken about before and is one of real concern. And it doesn't seem that long ago, Deputy Presiding Officer, that vaping companies were lobbying me in meetings in my own office, trying to get their support for them. And to their surprise, I was very strongly against the universal access. They thought I would support them because they were being marketed as a tool to quit smoking, which is the one area I would support their use, particularly as a medical intervention recommended by a medical professional. I may remember one particular vaping company asking who owns the vaping company. Of course, I knew it was a tobacco company. So the question I put to them was, are you really suggesting that tobacco companies are producing these products to help their customers stop using their products and therefore putting them out of business? Because by that logic, Deputy Presiding Officer, once they have helped every smoker quit, there would be no need for any of their products. If they are solely for smoking cessation, why are there so many flavours and additives to draw in users and potential users? I did inform them I wasn't that gullible. I know that Stephanie Callaghan and I attended one of those meetings and she got to see my frustration at this particular vaping company. And one of the things that really concerns me is you can go into significant high street confectionery stores and there are walls of these vaping products, these single-use vaping products. And everything I was concerned about back then has manifested itself and then some. I have a daughter in secondary school, and I was shocked at the level of vaping among pupils. There's anecdotal evidence, and she seemed to think that as much as half of the student population had tried or is regularly using vaping products. Moreover, there's a whole micro-industry with students around buying and selling these products in schools. Evidence the quantity of products confiscated daily by the campus policeman. Moreover, and more significantly, the level of students smoking tobacco, marijuana, or even worse, remains high and climbing. Vaping is a door to addiction and a step towards using these more harmful products instead of their marketing use of smoking cessation. I also would suggest that single-use vapes in and are of themselves a health hazard. As Gillian Mackay has said, there's so many single-use vapes being found on our beaches and in our open spaces. And to cycle lithium is incredibly difficult, especially from these vapes. So I think that I know we're short of time, Deputy Presiding Officer, so I'm going to try and give you some of that time back. But we do need to regulate the use of vapes much more effectively, keep them out of the hands of school children. The marketing budgets of tobacco firms are being used to entice entirely new users into their usage and then to even more harmful products. Their use is a habit as well as a social statement to their users. Peer pressure is a key driver, and after all, it's not really smoking, is it? And the wonderful flavours, bubblegum flavour, for goodness sake, yep, that's really aimed at adults wanting to quit. No, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's too easy for pupils to be drawn in, making the step to the next level of substance use and a bit easier. So, as a Parliament, surely we can come together. There are things that we can do and steps that we can take, steps that we have to take to make sure that we stamp out single-use vapes. And I say once again, I thank Gillian Mackay for giving me the opportunity to raise this once again, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Colin Smith. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Gillian Mackay for securing this debate today and thank the many contributions from across the Chamber who have covered many of the aspects of this. I'll try and limit myself to the cross-party group on accident prevention safety awareness, which I chair, and the work that we have done in these areas, and highlight areas that haven't been mentioned already. So the Child Action Prevention Trust have recently issued a warning about hospitals reporting growing numbers of children accidentally swallowing liquid nicotine from e-cigarettes, refills and disposables. There's a risk of poisoning from swallowing e-cigarette liquid. The symptoms are usually mild and include nausea and vomiting, but serious poisoning can happen after swallowing larger amounts. As with medicines or cleaning products, e-cigarettes should be kept away from children and toddlers. And while no deaths have yet been reported in the UK, a two-year-old girl from Israel was fatally poisoned from swallowing an e-cigarette refill. This reminds us to keep nicotine products of all kind away from children and toddlers. As Katrina Phillips from CAT says, babies put everything in their mouths. It's how they explore the world around them. Toddlers are intensely curious, so if you leave your bag on the floor, they're at it like a shot. And remember to keep harmful things like e-cigarette refills where a small child can't find them. That's the tip of the iceberg. Disposable vapes and refillables, as we know, contain lithium-ion batteries. This is an area that the cross-party group has returned to and many times because of the danger of ingestion of lithium-ion batteries for babies and toddlers. And we are discarding these into our environment, where, as Gillian had said, they can easily be picked up. These things break up when they're disposed, so you get the plastic, you get the broken bits of copper, you get that all that environmental issue. So these are really, really serious issues for children. Of course, the cross-party group also works very closely with trading standards officers from Scotland, and they have been talking about the complexity of the regulatory landscape regarding these products. Those bought online, you don't often get them coming from reputable production. I use reputable ironically, in that sense, since I don't think any of it is particularly reputable. But they have identified that products coming in through the internet and delivered direct from homes contain more nicotine than is recommended under the EU British standards, more complex chemicals that have not been tested for human use in this area, and also containing greater volumes and poorly designed products, more likely to lead to the other area which has been of concern to the cross-party group, and that is the zombie batteries, as mentioned already. Thermal runaway can happen on any lithium battery. If people want to know how important this is, for those who went on holiday, went through an airport today, you're asked if you have any lithium iron battery products in your luggage. And that is because it's too dangerous for those to go in the hold in case there is a thermal runaway during a flight. And yet we are discarding these. And in the volumes that were mentioned by Alexander in the report that he quoted, which I was going to use as well. So for everyone in the chamber today, there's a complete consensus on this. We have to do something about this. And I welcome the Scottish Government consulting on the ban of disposable vapes. And I hope that it can lead to greater regulation of this product throughout the UK. And thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. Ms Adamson, I'm conscious of we still have a large number of members who wish to participate in the debate, so I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I call on Gillian Mackay to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Are members agreed to extend the debate? That's agreed. Thank you very much indeed. And with the discipline shown by members speaking to date, I should be able to protect the 4 minutes of the remaining members. And with that, I call Colin Smith to be followed by Stephanie Callan, but up to 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And thank you to Gillian Mackay for lodging her motion for debate. Presiding Officer, the great vape debate is often, are e-cigarettes saving smokers or creating new addicts? I think the reality is it is probably a bit of both. Smoking rates in Scotland have seen a welcome decrease from 28% of adults in 2003 to 11% in 2021, thanks to policy interventions such as the ban on smoking in public places. And given that vaping is clearly dangerous but does appear less damaging than smoking, I'm prepared to accept that cigarettes can help people quit smoking tobacco and hopefully continue that trend. But as we've heard...
Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. The paediatrician we heard from at the roundtable on Monday raised the concern that actually what we're doing is we're trading two health-harming products off against each other rather than recognising the health-harming nature of vapes themselves. Would the member agree with me that we need to recognise that health-harming product itself and treat it on its own rather than trading it off against cigarettes?
Colin Smith.
I absolutely accept that. And I think what's also important, as we've heard from a number of members, that actually with vaping, we're facing a growing avalanche of children and young people who never smoked, never had any intention of smoking, but have now turned to choose vaping. As Ash Scotland highlighted in March, using the government's own figures, regular e-cigarette use by 15-year-olds has actually tripled in the last 5 years, and it's more than doubled for 13-year-olds, with single-use vapes the product choice for the vast majority of young people. And that's not surprising. As we've heard, these products, the brightly coloured, flute-flavoured, cheap vapes, are obscenely being marketed in shops, displays and on social media platforms to specifically and quite clearly target young people. The gangsters behind many of these products, frankly, are no better than those in big tobacco firms who glamorise smoking in the 60s and 70s when they knew they were killing people. So, Presiding Officer, I am frustrated that the Government hasn't yet listened to the long-standing calls from Asthma and Lung UK Scotland and Ash Scotland and others and fully enacted the remaining regulations from the 2016 Health, Tobacco, Nicotine and Care Scotland Act to restrict the marketing and promotion of vaping products. And I hope we'll see that soon. But we do need to go further. As this debate has shown, alongside the health impact of e-cigarettes, the toxic and single-use plastic waste caused by disposable vapes has become a new environmental crisis. Last week we saw the stark figures from Material Focus that the number of disposable vapes thrown away in the UK has quadrupled to 5 million a week in the past year. More than 7 million are bought every week and just 17% recycle those vapes in a shop or local recycling centre. Inspirational campaigners like Laura Young have highlighted that the choice of disposing of our vapes is often on the streets and in our play parks across Scotland. The industry has failed to show responsibility by providing proper information on its products on how and where to dispose of vapes in a safe, sustainable way, and they fail to put in place a proper network of take-back schemes. Calling for a bit more recycling is not the answer. There are already alternatives that also need to be better regulated, but disposable vapes are an unnecessary evil that could and should be banned. Yes, we need to make the detail right. Any laws need to be future-proof so they can be easily adapted through regulations if any new products are developed. The up-and-coming Circular Economy Bill is an opportunity to follow the lead that Wales are showing. England too, it seems, this week, possibly under the current government, but certainly under the next Labour government. So if the Scottish Government don't include a ban on the sale of disposable vapes in their Circular Economy Bill, and I hope that they do, but if they don't, Labour MPs, MSPs will amend that bill to try to take disposable vapes off our shelves and away from littering our streets.
Thank you, Mr Smith. I now call Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, thank you for doing your absolute best to make sure that we all get to make a contribution today, and thanks also to Gillian Mackay for bringing this debate. And I can certainly back up what my colleague Brian Whittle was saying earlier on today too. That we're so pushed for time today is a testament to just how seriously we all take the environmental and health impacts of vaping. And firstly, I do want to welcome the consultation. There really is no place for single-use vapes in a zero-waste Scotland, and the array of discarded, shiny-coloured, used vapes that are scattered everywhere is a really hot topic when I'm out and around dog walking. The meteoric rise in vaping amongst young people has rocked all of us, I think, and the Scottish Youth Parliament report released earlier this month, Single-Use Many Voices, highlights that 84% of young respondents have seen no information on where and how to dispose of single-use vapes. We must take that seriously, our responsibility to provide good information around disposal and use the same platforms the tobacco industry do to glamorise vaping, the ones that young people use every day. Presiding Officer, we've heard plenty in the health and wellbeing impacts of vaping, and none of us want to imagine how these could impact families across Scotland in the future. And let's make no mistake, the tobacco industry will continue to promote misinformation and sell vaping as a positive lifestyle choice to our young people, and we need to help them fight back. So this will be the focus of my speech today. Presiding Officer, I recently spoke to a young constituent of mine in her early 20s who talked to the shock she felt on realising the high levels of nicotine and the range of chemicals that are in e-liquids. She tells me that pubs and clubs are full of young people openly vaping, believing that social vaping on weekends is pretty much harmless. It's merely water vapour with no real consequences. Knowing the facts, she has stopped vaping completely, now aware that the high nicotine intake impacts brain development and the increased vulnerability of her age group to nicotine addiction. She quite rightly sees herself and her friends as victims of a targeted marketing campaign. And trust me, she is really angry, and she is setting all her friends straight on what she sees as the dangers. Presiding Officer, as my young constituent demonstrates, arming our young people with the facts is the biggest weapon that we have in this fight against tobacco industry propaganda. Unfortunately, the large sums big tobacco spends in influencing social perceptions often do work. And with the report I mentioned earlier telling us that young people feel anxious and trapped with their vaping consumption, that's incredibly sad. Quite frankly, it's devastating to think that what we once used as a smoking cessation tool has been used to peddle a lifestyle con. Presiding Officer, I could also say much about the amazing work that's happening across my constituency by Public Health Lanarkshire and organisations such as Landed, who've worked tirelessly to educate and inform over the last 6 years. But I'm aware we're very short of time today. So let me finish today with this. We already know enough to take action on vaping. We must not delay. We must use the legislation we've got. Let us not repeat the mistakes of the 50s when emerging dangers around smoking first arose. Let us act now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Callaghan. I now call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Ruskell.
Yep, thanks very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start and join others by thanking Gillian Mackay for her leadership on this issue, both inside and out of Parliament, working with tireless campaigners such as Laura Young and the many groups and organisations, both health and environmental, who are backing this call for a ban on disposable vapes.
I mean, what we often see these days, particularly in this Parliament, is that whenever change is proposed, particularly increased regulation, we often get calls of, you know, catastrophe for whatever vested interest that's resistant to the change. But what's really striking about the call to restrict vapes is that there isn't really much of that kind of debate at all. You know, there's a lot of unanimity on this issue. I mean, I'm now the 10th speaker in this debate, and every single speech in this debate so far has backed the call for a ban on disposable vapes. And I think that's a point that I'm sure, you know, won't be lost on the minister in closing this debate. And I think it's all the more remarkable because there has been a huge lobby from the vaping industry over the last 5 years in this Parliament. I think Brian Whittle talked about some of his experiences of how that's played out. And I too went through several years of just seeing constant requests in my inbox from PR companies fronting up vaping industries who are wanting to meet with me. But it's probably because vape products are so uniquely problematic that we're seeing that unanimity of concern. And I think it's why we've seen now 29 out of 32 local authorities across Scotland all passing motions calling for vapes to be banned or controlled. Because if you wanted to sit down and actually design a cheap disposable product that litters the countryside with plastics, electronics and batteries, causes a fire risk, can't be recycled or reused, and puts young people at risk of bronchitis, breathing problems and nicotine addiction, it would pretty much be the perfect target for a ban. And yet this is exactly what disposable vapes are. And as lawmakers, we're still really catching up with the reality of that. And it's clear that communities are seeing the impact everywhere. Fife Street Champions, for example, picked up 664 disposable vapes in 1 month this spring. Keep Scotland Beautiful surveys show that 44% of people are seeing disposable vapes far more often littering their communities. And I'm sure that many of the coastal communities that are going to be involved in the MCS beach cleans in next week are going to see increasing numbers of vapes appearing on their beaches. And all of this, of course, builds up to that staggering national picture that we've heard of in this debate, where, you know, Zero Waste Scotland estimated last year 2.7 million vapes were littered in Scotland alone. I mean, hardly surprising, given that we're now seeing an 18-fold increase in the use of disposable vapes from 1 year to the next. Now, the health impacts on young people are truly concerning, precisely because we don't know what kind of ticking time bomb actually exists here. I think a point that was made very well by Rona Mackay. And this is yet another example of why following the precautionary principle is so important, because corporate interests shouldn't be allowed to mess around with the unknown long-term health of our children just because there's a big short-term market opportunity. So, Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank Gillian Mackay again for leading this debate, and I'm certainly going to be looking forward to the Minister's response about what the next steps towards banning vapes in Scotland and across the rest of the UK will be. So, thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Ruskell. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Carol Mochin. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too congratulate my colleague Gillian Mackay on securing this debate. It's a hugely important debate, obviously, by the amount of MSPs that are speaking in it. I also want to thank Asthma Lung UK Scotland, British Lung Foundation and ASH Scotland for their engagement and very helpful briefings ahead of this debate. And there's a couple of people I need to give a shout out to in Dumfries and Galloway Council at the Youth Work Department, Kelly Ross and Mark Malloy. They've met with me and we've been starting to work together to highlight and tackle the issues of vaping in our young people across Dumfries and Galloway. And as co-convener of the Lung Health Cross Party Group and as a registered nurse, I'm really interested in the impact of vaping, not only on lung health, especially with the very serious health concerns that have been expressed by medical experts. But I'm also interested in Gillian Mackay's motion, as it states that she's extremely concerned about the environmental impact of the single-use vapes and the safety of these devices. Presiding Officer, I'll just pick up on a couple of things because I know our time is a bit challenged today. The materials used in disposable vapes, they do make them a potential hazard to human wildlife, to humans, to wildlife and the environment when they are thrown away. And the lithium is used for batteries. It's a precious metal which is already facing a global shortage. Over 10 tonnes of lithium was thrown out with disposable vapes in the UK in the last year. and that's enough to make batteries for 1,200, that's 1,200 electric cars. If we're going to address a climate emergency and enable a green transition, we need to make the best use of scarce materials like lithium. If disposable vapes were rechargeable, they could be reused up to 300 times, and this would drastically reduce the number of vapes ending up in landfill every day. Vaping can reduce the function of the lungs due to the disturbance of gas exchange and the inflammation in the tissues that it causes. So in my nurse career in the operating room, I used to work on people's lungs laparoscopically, and sometimes you would see directly the damage of lungs by cigarette smoking. But we are now starting to see e-cigarette vaping-associated lung injury, which is also known as EVALI, and a public health investigation in Illinois and Wisconsin in the US found the median age of patients suffering from EVALI was 21 years old, presiding officer. Despite what the industry might say, nicotine does have a detrimental health effect. Adolescents are more vulnerable to nicotine dependency than adults. Chronic nicotine exposure can impact brain development. And we heard from Dr. Jonathan Coutts at Gillian Mackay's roundtable on Monday, and Dr. Coutts presented at a lung health cross-party group that my colleague Alexander Stewart and I attended a few months ago, and he presented the facts around the harm that vaping does to young people's brains. We know that there's an impact on brain development, and it can contribute to cognitive and attention deficit conditions and worsen mood disorders, including depression and suicidal thoughts. So this is a huge issue. It's clear that something needs to be done. One of the statistics that I found was that one vape is like smoking 52 cigarettes. So it's something that, you know, clearly we need to be concerned about. One thing I would like to know from the Minister is that the Internal Market Act might need obviously consideration if we are going to propose changes to regulation. So I'd be interested to know whether there needs to be some kind of exclusion in the Internal Market Act for regulations to be taken forward.
And you do need to conclude, Ms. Harper.
Presiding officer, it's my last sentence. I'm thanking Gillian Mackay again. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Harper. I now call Carol Mochen, last speaker in the open debate, up to 4 minutes, Ms. Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding officer. And like others, can I take the opportunity at the beginning to thank Gillian Mackay for bringing this debate to the chamber. Really important, as members have mentioned. As we have seen today, there is willingness across the chamber to progress a response to this issue with purpose, and I therefore hope the government will outline soon how it will do that, and it will consider giving some government time to this debate so we can have a more in-depth discussion. I think it is right that we talk of the serious environmental impacts of single-use vapes. What they have created is a throwaway culture, as we've heard, damaging to our environment and damaging to our efforts to tackle the climate emergency. I'm not going to restate all the effects that members have so well put to the chamber today, as I do know that we are, you know, marching towards the second sitting of the chamber. So, however, I do want to use a small amount of the time that we have to talk about something that has been mentioned before and mentioned in the motion, is the concerningly high usage rate amongst our young people. And I want to quote from Sheila Duffy, who is from Ash Scotland, who has quoted that single-use vapes are creating addiction among young children and young people, including very young children in primary school and lower secondary schools, where we haven't seen much of an issue with tobacco. And she made that statement, and I thought it was really concerning. The content of these vapes are such that they're becoming addictive for people of an age where tobacco addiction was generally unheard of. And this has been exacerbated by the fact that the products are easy to access. They're bright, colourful, we've heard from other members. They catch the eye. And in comparison to similar products, they can be cheap. So that brings together the health and the environmental impacts of these single-use vapes. I want to just move on quickly. I have been trying to ascertain the numbers of people presenting to hospital, addiction or other health services with complications linked to vaping, and what has become very apparent is that there may need to be some discussion with government to liaise with the health boards to consider having a separate logging option for health concerns or complications relating to vapes, because it is really difficult to find out what the actual figures are like for that. And I do think it would be useful for us to separate out smoking and vapes, as other members have mentioned. I know we're so tight for time, Presiding Officer, so I really am just going to conclude. I think this has been a very worthwhile debate, and there's been many reasonable suggestions right across the parties, right across the chamber, being brought forward by members. And so it is clear that we need to deal with this environmental impact. I look forward to the Minister's contribution, and I do understand it is an environmental debate that we're having, and you have responsibility for those environmental impacts. So I would like to ask, what will the government do now? I think, picking up on Stephanie Callaghan's point, what are we going to do right now? How can we work across the UK? Because there has been some commitments made from the UK government. And I would ask the Minister if she could look to working across portfolio to see whether there is something that we can do about recording the damaging impacts of vaping and e-cigarettes, particularly around these single-use vapes. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mochen. And I invite the Minister to respond to the debate around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I will join my fellow members in congratulating Gillian Mackay for securing this debate and thanking her for her ongoing campaigning on this issue. As we can see from the contributions to the debate and the energy and focus that has been generated in the community and councils across Scotland about the seriousness of this debate. From the debate today, I'm very comforted that we all understand the issues well and that we all agree on the seriousness of the concerns being raised. I'd like to also specifically thank some members of the Scottish Youth Parliament who have spoken to me about single-use vapes on more than one occasion and really wanted to emphasise their concerns for their peers' health and also for the environment. This is very, very much a matter that concerns young people. Carol Mochen, Alexander Stewart, Colin Smith and others all flagged up their concerns about young people's health, that single-use vapes have perhaps become more of a pathway into smoking than a pathway out of smoking. And with 5 million single-use vapes being discarded a week in the UK, it is indeed hard to imagine that they are primarily being used by people who are trying to quit. I can imagine that parents must be terrified that their children are becoming a new generation, a next generation addicted to nicotine. Carol Mochen makes a really good point on the data collection, and please be assured that I am working closely with the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health on this matter, so absolutely a cross-portfolio matter. On the environmental side, Rona Bukakai makes really good points about litter, and Emma Harper also highlights the waste of that valuable lithium that we know is so important to a transition and is also so dangerous, potentially, when discarded irresponsibly. I met last week with some managers of waste facilities who made a very emotional plea about the safety of their workers. Batteries have been implicated in 700 fires in bin lorries and recycling centres in the UK. That is a serious danger to workers in that industry. And the plea from the managers of those waste management facilities was for us to take urgent action to protect that worker's safety. Mercedes Vialba makes excellent points about litter on our streets. I see the same in my streets as Mercedes observed in Dundee. Retailers are obliged to provide facilities for people who buy the vapes to return them to those retailers, or they must pay into a fund to provide recycling facilities for these. It's clear to me that retailers are not doing that. That work isn't undertaking, so something that we must look at urgently in addition to considering consultation on the ban is the enforcement of those rules. Retailers need to be responsible and make sure these products are not ending up in the hands of children and that they are providing
you're meeting their obligations to provide adequate recycling. Many members in this chamber highlighted the difficulty of recycling these materials when you have a battery embedded in a single-use plastic product. Single-use electronics, even worse than single-use plastics. I feel we are too far along in the climate emergency for new single-use plastic products. We have been working very hard to remove single-use plastics from, and so many industries are working to do that, to have this industry create a whole new single-use plastic product, which has tripled in numbers over the last couple of years and created this serious environmental and human health issue is, of course, a great concern to us. I want to thank Stephanie Callaghan, Brian Whittle, Kenneth Gibson for highlighting the nature of some of the companies that are involved in this marketing and the danger that they place to our children by putting profits ahead of human health and environmental health. I want to reassure members that we are taking serious action on this matter in terms of Colin Smith's note about the circular economy bill. It is actually not required. We already do have the powers to do this. We are looking at a range of options, but we have the power to ban problematic single-use products with our existing powers if there is sufficient evidence of environmental harm. And the enormous growth of single-use vaping in the recent years absolutely provides that, you know, is providing that evidence of that. So we can use those powers to come forward. Although, as Emma Harper points out, such implementation of these powers could potentially come into conflict with the Internal Market Act. However, yesterday I had a very constructive meeting with my counterparts in the Welsh and UK governments, and we have agreed to work together on our approach up to and including a ban. So that is something all the nations of the UK have in common, to work together. And that would, of course, be the most effective approach, to have a common approach. Now, a ban will take some time to work towards, if that is where we're heading. And there are other actions that we need to take in the meantime, as highlighted by members, on enforcement, on product design, and on marketing. And I will be working with my counterparts in the other nations of the UK on this matter. Certainly, Brian. Mr. Brian
Whittle.
It occurs to me, if we get to the place we want to be in terms of banning, we're going to have a problem with those children who are already addicted to nicotine. What can we do, maybe working with the Cabinet Secretary for Health to address that particular issue?
Minister, then give you the time back.
I take that point on board, that we do have potentially a serious public health problem of young people addicted to nicotine. I'll take that on board, and let's work together, hopefully cross-party, but certainly with my ministerial colleagues, on how we can address that issue. None of us want to see a new generation addicted to nicotine, and to see potentially smoking numbers increase after having decreased them so successfully, and then to see the human health cost of that decision. Scottish Government is committed to taking the necessary action as a priority, and I am encouraged by this debate that our actions that we take forward on this will be widely supported by colleagues across the chamber. So thank you again to everyone for participating today in this debate, and I look forward to working with you as we work on options up to and including a potential ban. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2 o'clock.